Hello everyone, and welcome to another edition of Dorothy DeLay MasterClass Series. Today we have a fantastic guest artist, wonderful violinist, Gil Shaham, joining us. So Gil, please, whenever you're ready, you can unmute yourself.
Hi everybody.
Hi Gil, it's delightful to have you with us.
So good to be with you, Dima.
It's interesting that, you know, when I started thinking about this series, which are, of course, a tribute to Dorothy DeLay, who was a graduate of Michigan State University in 1937, one of the first former students I approached was you. And you were very kind to support the idea. It took a little bit longer than we anticipated, but it's wonderful to have you at the end of our school year, because we had fantastic two semesters of guest artists, and I'm really thankful to everyone, and I'm so glad that you can join us today.
I'm so honored, and bravo, Dima, my gosh, that series that you put together is amazing, you know, and that kind of a tribute to Mr. Lay's legacy, right? So many of those people studied with Mr. Lay or were connected to her other ways.
Yes, yeah. So we'll talk, of course, much more during the webinar between our performers. And perhaps now we can introduce our first violinist who is going to play for you. Her name is Sofia Levchenko. She's originally from Uzbekistan, from Tashkent. And she's been studying for, I think, 3 years already, at least 3 years. Maybe 4 years. Hello, Sofia. And she's going to play Ysaye Sonata number 3, Ballade, for you.
Thank you.
Brava, Sophia! What a great job!
Thank you so much.
Nice to meet you. I'm Gil.
Nice to meet you.
Wow. So actually, both you and Daniela, who will play after you, you're playing pieces that I never played, that I always wanted to. So let's see. I see too much of my face. I wanna see. I'm gonna switch to gallery. Okay, now I can see you. So, Sophia, how long have you been working on this piece, and why?
Regularly, I've been working maybe for last 2-3 months. And I started last summer. I just learned the text and I left it for a while until actually recently. And I just now like in the process of working on this piece. And why? Because first of all, shame on me, but I never played Ysaye in my life. So nothing from that. And I wanted to learn and to just
There's no shame in that. Yeah, always good to learn. Yeah.
Yeah, and I just I thought that since this is like very familiar and short and super beautiful sonata, I just decided to start with this one and to also learn some new techniques in my playing to maybe achieve something. Yep.
Is it very hard to learn?
Well, I mean, not hard to learn, but hard to run through.
Hard to run through.
Yes.
It's like a stamina kind of thing.
Yeah, first of all, for me, honestly, to keep this theme in my head and to know which one I'm playing right now and where to which chord I'm going after, this is a very hard to keep in. And like, yeah, and just to, I think, just to run through it and to do whatever I was planning to do is not working out yet. Is that good?
No, you sound excellent and you're really on top of it. Yeah, I think you have you have no issues with reaching all those notes and all these difficult passages. This is really stream of conscious, but I know that it's dedicated to Enescu. Mm-hmm. And this is really out of nowhere. Maybe somebody out there knows. I just recently got the music for the Enescu cadenza to the Brahms concerto, you know? Mm-hmm. And I guess Enescu was very fond of the Brahms concerto and performed it often. And I wonder if this, you know, if that's a little bit of a Brahms, but even the whole, you know, it's a little bit, you know, maybe it's a little bit of a message that they had between each other, Enescu and these. I have no idea, but maybe somebody out there knows. You know what I was really impressed was how you were able, you know, to hold those long forte notes. I don't know how you hold that so long and so clear, and I just want to change the bow. I just want to play up a. Even then it doesn't sound, or even use tubas. I don't know. But anyway, you have no issue with that. And there are a couple of others like that, right? There's a, I don't know how you hold that so long. Only so long I can hold that. And the other one is this one, right? Right, that's very difficult. Yeah, you know, while you were playing, I was trying to think of, you know, what I could possibly say to help. And I was thinking about a couple of things. I was thinking about longer phrases and clearer rhythm. And although I have to say, your rhythm is very clear. Like this piece, I think, can be very tricky for an audience, you know, because violinists sometimes really take so much rubato that it's hard for a listener to follow. But I feel like maybe can be still clear, and some places maybe a little more bow. You people who know me know that when I don't know what to say, I say please use more bow. But I really do think maybe there are a couple of passages where you can. So do you want to try? Do you want to play just from the top?
Mm-hmm.
And let's see if I can show you what I mean. Yeah. Brava. Brava. So I have a couple of questions about that phrase. Because I wonder if it can be more one gesture. You know, when I sometimes work with new composers, I remember Bill Bolcom comes to mind, but you know, I played some of his pieces, and he, you know, I would adjust for my technique, some things I would phrase, and he would say, "No, Gil, this is one gesture. This is why, you know." And I wonder if this is really just one ascent from that, you know, and somehow one big crescendo. So I guess what that means is, and I hear this often where people end the phrase, but maybe it continues. And you know, I don't know the notes, but maybe it really continues through the bolchin. You know. Is that right? Something like that? Okay, so maybe let's try that. Just, yeah, one time and just very soft, very legato, one phrase. Like, imagine a singer. I mean, I don't know how you do that last note, but imagine a singer taking this whole phrase in one breath. Brava. Now I have one more question. By the way, I love that. I don't know how you, do you like that?
Yeah.
I don't know. I love that. For me, it's like, we've started the piece. You know, I think that's maybe the gesture he was after, you know? So I personally think maybe poco stringendo is just poco, should be a little bit less. But anyway, even if we do stringendo, how does that connect to the da 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 da? Do we continue it through the next two?
Through
those sixths at the top?
Uh-huh.
Or do we suddenly do a writ there?
I can try, yeah, to be more. To build one more.
Can you do me a favor one time? Let's play it just strict rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
No stringendo at all. No rallentando, just in tempo, piano, legato, crescendo, and then that. I don't know how you do that. Top note. Yeah. That was great. I just, maybe those in the those eighth notes in the middle, maybe those slurs can also be a little bit, you know, those bowl changes can be still a little more legato. You know? Yeah, some, maybe, you know? Yeah, I mean, in a way, I guess the top note needs something for the arrival.
Mm-hmm.
It's all augmented chord,
mm-hmm,
and mysterious whole tone scale, right? Yeah. Where are we going? And then maybe it's kind of a dominant chord on the top. Maybe, but you know, some sort of mystery. I think that sounds great. And then let's continue. Let's go on after that. Thank you. Brava, brava, brava. So, you know, I guess I always tell people that for me, maybe the most primal, the primary message that we send is rhythm, you know? And I think that's always true, not just in music, you know, even when you're having a conversation, you want the beat to keep going. You know, if it gets lost, then, you know, the conversation falter, you know, or, you know, there's something about the regular rhythm. You know, I know this from experience that when I would be on stage and I would play some phrases and then I would take some rubatos or things I wanted to do, and then I would see people, you know, look at their clock or, you know, look at their watches, you know. So I think there's something mesmerizing about keeping exactly the beat. And you know, maybe, you know, this is so complicated with the chords and the rolls and the double stuff, but maybe just for simplicity's sake, let's play. Somehow that's the goal, right? We want it to be that simple sounding, right? But with all the mishigas.
So do one.
And in fact maybe this has a beat, you know, even though it's very mysterious and pianissimo. You know, maybe there's a beat there somewhere, not the way I play it, but maybe somewhere, you know. Do you want to start from there? From
yeah.
That's great. I love that. I know that we don't have much time. You know, the one thing I would say is maybe the very top note. Sometimes, you know, when you hear singers sing, it's all about the top notes. And so they may hold it a little bit longer, you know? You know, so that the top note with a great singer is always too long, but still in time, you know? So too long, but still in time. And then... yeah, you know what, let's skip ahead because I know we don't have so much time. I feel the same about these kind of passages, you know, that 5-4, you know, it's such a kind of lopsided rhythm, and if you can really hear 5 every bar, I think that can be really effective, you know. You know, there's something that could be really kind of, I don't know, effective about those 5-4 bars. Do you want to play that passage? That's great. So now with your ta-yada, that one just at the end there, I feel like you would be much more comfortable with more bow on that D. Ta-yada. Sorry, excuse my singing.
This one?
Can you possibly have more bow for the D?
Mm-hmm. Ah, forte.
Yeah. Does that feel better?
Yeah.
I don't know. So, you know, I can't read these notes. I don't know what the... Is that right? What are the notes there at the top? And the three before that? Very strange. Right. So that's another one. We're at the top of the phrase. And these notes are so, this harmonic, what would you call it? Harmonic, enharmonic progression is so weird. We have to be super clear about it. You know, it has to be, and maybe it needs a little time. You know, maybe that's important, you know, to be clear about that more than any other notes. You know, this can be anything. Could be anything, the beginning of that bar. Do you want to do it from the beginning of that bar? And then on those fourth and fifth beats, as clear as possible, and as much bow as possible.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And da-da-da-da-da-da. So everybody knows that's the highest note. Am I right? That's the highest note we've reached? That's the high A again?
Yeah.
That's great. You know, for the legato, maybe I feel a little bit you're enunciating every note with the bow. But maybe, you know, if the bow is just, you know, just like separate, like you cut your brain into two halves. This, the right hand is just da 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 da, and the notes just change with the left hands, not with the right hand at all. You know, maybe it'll be even more legato. Da, 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 da. That's great. And don't forget, this is the highest note.
Right, sorry.
I love that. I think that sounds pretty great. I feel like, you know, I'm not there in the room with you, but I think maybe you have room to use a little more bow, even on, you know, all these, you know, I remember when I was younger, I used to watch these videos. Now you can find everything on the YouTube, you know, but there are these wonderful videos of David Oistrakh. I don't know if you ever saw some of these, and I always tell people, you know, he plays Corelli Chrysler. Do you know that piece?
Mm-hmm.
I remember watching it and thinking, how much bow is he? He's just using the whole bow, you know, on every note. You know, and you watch videos of like the, maybe Dima knows. It's like, I think Leningrad State Philharmonic, they play Tchaikovsky Symphony, and they just use the full bow on every. You know, and, you know, when they do it, it sounds great, you know. So, yeah, maybe there's room to use even a little more bow. No bow pressure, but just a lot of bow, you know, like a lot of air for a singer.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to just do from
mm-hmm.
You know, and then, you know, I know that I said about the top being so important, but the bottom is also super. In fact, you know, Yo-Yo Ma, he always says, so he's a cellist, you know. But and sometimes he has some good ideas for violinists too. He says always phrase towards the bottom. And if the bottom is clear, then everything else will float and come together easily, you know? And it's true. It's true for violin too. Not even, maybe even more in a piece like this. But also when you collaborate, you know, that register on the violin has trouble coming through an orchestra, has trouble coming through a piano. So it's always good to phrase towards the bottom. That's it. I'll stop talking and I'll let you play. That sounds good. How do you feel? So do you want to continue there where you just stopped?
Yeah, good.
Sure. I guess I was wondering if this kind of dance, right? This is a 3/8 dance.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe this. What are these? Do you know what that? There's like a -2- and then -3-.
Actually, what you were referring to before, and I was going to say that.
Please.
Is I actually, you know, he created this kind of sign for using lots of bow. So those dashes as when you use a lot of bow. So there's some passages or and then all those. You meant about this one, yeah?
So yes. Actually, that same place right there where you played. There's also -2 above that, and then -3. Do you see that?
Also, like the dashes, if they are like this, they
this use is a string, yeah.
Yeah, which string I should use?
No. But so what is in? what are those 2 and 3? Do you see that?
You know, I don't have music in front of me, but
yeah.
Right. I think he indicates the strings when he wants to use.
I don't know.
You,
let's see if I can find it.
Just a number 2?
Yeah, the number
Oh,
two.
it's a 2 beats and 3 beats in the bar.
Ah, so that's kind of the dance thing. That's what I thought. Yeah, so I think that's quite a an interesting rhythm, you know, kind of like almost like a Basque zortziko or something, you know, like a 5/5/8 kind of bar. Yes, so I guess my question was, what would happen? You know, this page. He says in tempo giusto, right? So tempo giusto, I always think means, you know, just tempo, whatever that means, you know, like strict tempo, very strict tempo. And e con bravura, which I think you have in spades, you know, but I think maybe it could be more giusto, you know, maybe very strict until there's just one writ at the end, you know. So even you know, maybe this is, it's a different character, but the dance continues, you know. Maybe, well, what happens if you try to just very strict, and then here when we come with this 30 seconds, it's kind of it's almost Bachian, you know, if you get like the harpsichordist plays the 16th, plays 16th, and then he plays the 30 seconds, you know. I can't play this, but you know, something like that. Do you want to play this page one more time? And just a lot of giusto. How did that feel? Do you like that? I don't know.
I mean, yeah, I'm getting more into character of like one whole thing.
I feel like maybe that's maybe one big gesture, maybe kind of longer phrase, maybe just something to consider, you know, and then you can drag to trash and delete.
Yeah, frames.
You know, I know that you said also about stamina, and also I know we're running out of time. But I was wondering, this looks very difficult to me. But this calme section, you know, there's an. You know? Can you play it once, you know, without the grace notes? You know, the only rubato that he writes for us is that little cede, you know, a hold back kind of. What if you, I kind of imagine like a pianist playing some kind of, I don't know, you know, Debussy or something, you know, but yeah, can you play it one time and just very strict rhythm?
Oh, was out great. Sorry, sorry.
Maybe. Just for now.
Mm-hmm.
Bravo. Bravo. So, you know, I think this is very, very difficult, but deceptively difficult. I don't know if you ever record yourself. You know, when we were students, Dima and I, right? We used to have cassette recorders, but I would never do it. Everybody said you should record yourself. I would never do it because I always felt, you know, I don't like listening to myself. But actually, it solves many, many problems very quickly. So I recommend it. Anyway, you know, my teacher used to say on violin, there are four types of articulation. You can articulate by switching strings, right? Or by putting your finger down, or by lifting your finger, right? And what am I missing here? By switching strings, putting a finger down, lifting finger, or changing the bow. So there are four types of articulation. You know, if you think of a piano, they only have the one, right? It's the hammer. But for violin, there's four types, and to get it really even is complicated. You know, it's very difficult. Also, I think part of the issue is when you're going from lower string to higher string is different from going from a higher string to a lower string. It's a different motion of your hand. This is not easy, it's very difficult to do. So there's no other way. You have to think every note. I'll change the string now. Now I'll change another string. Another string. Now I'm gonna put my finger down. Now I'm gonna lift my finger. Now I'm gonna change my string the other direction. Right? You know, there's no other way. And in a way, slowing down and verbalizing it, you know, not actually saying it out loud, although I guess maybe that would help, but somehow having it super clear helps. So I know we don't really have much time, but do you want to play from there, maybe to the end?
Okay.
Thank you. So nice to meet you. So nice to hear you.
I'm so glad to meet you. Thank you so much.
Please keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Yeah, brava.
Thank you, Sophia.
Dima, do you play this one?
Yes, I play it, and actually I find it very, very helpful. And I think this year I insisted that several of my students will learn this piece, because the more I practice this, the more I realize how it can be really helping to develop, can help to develop a different aspect of violin playing. Because there's lots of double stops, there's lots of voicing, and I think it's a great piece in terms of the just getting some of the just simple violinistic ideas, but in a very creative musical way. So I very often even warm up with this piece, because it's just a couple of minutes of playing a few phrases, not necessarily the fast ones, but voicing with a double stop, those six, you know, I find it very, very, very helpful.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great piece too. Would you say this is the most popular one of the six? Is this the one that?
Perhaps, yeah, because it's a shorter one, one movement, and I mean, it has beautiful melodies, and it's very virtuosic. It seems, I mean, I think Ysaye was a real genius, because he was able to make this sound like a very, very challenging and virtuosic, and it sounds like it's incredible pyrotechnic techniques and all this time. But some of the passages are just very natural. You know, violinistic approach is just some of the scale, some of the whatever comes, you know, to the fingerboard. He just used the same fingerings. Yeah, I mean, I think only violinists could write in that way and find such a joy in making music out of this.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. I love going to Cincinnati, you know, where they have the big Ysaye statue, and what an amazing legacy he left there, you know.
Yeah, we had Kurt Sussman's house just recently as a guest, and some of his students were playing from his studio. So there were some of the pink pictures of people who, one lady actually, I think it's a Sterling Foundation or something. This lady actually was studying with Ysaye.
Oh, wow.
He was teaching there in 1920, I think.
She spoke.
She already passed away, but
she
was there, yes. And so he reminded me that Ysaye was really spending a couple of years in Cincinnati, which was incredible.
Yeah, it's so cool.
He was quite a figure, you know, and we talked with you before that this is such an incredible group of Belgian musicians who created such a movement and pride for the Belgian music. Frank and Chausson was there, so it's great. Next piece is going to be actually Chausson Poeme, played by Daniela Diaz, and perhaps we can invite Daniela. And after we'll talk a little bit more with Gil.
Hi, Maestro. Okay, can you hear me well? So here's my pianist, Chen. She will be playing Chausson with me.
Looking forward. Thanks, both.
Thank you.
Brava, bravi both. It's Chen, right? What did I and Daniela and Chen? I was trying to follow the piano part. You're adding more than the one I have here in the piano reduction. I love it. Is that based on the score?
Versions actually, the ones that are online. I bought the Urtext version, and it gives you different options. Actually, I guess many pianists have gone through the hassle of playing this humongous orchestration. So, I guess.
And you know, Dima and I were talking before about the story,
yes,
of the piece,
yes.
And so after we spoke, I went to Google. And I found this article by Jessica Duchin. Do you know her?
Yes, I do.
And she, you know, she wrote a big book about Faure, about Gabriel Faure, and suggested that maybe,
yep,
this story has to do
with him. Yes.
With,
yeah,
Faure and his romance with Marianne Viardo, I think.
Correct.
And so, you know, this is another piece I never played, always wanted to play. So beautiful. But so do you feel that the story takes place through the piece?
So I do know that at this point, French composers, you know, they were trying to create this distinctiveness in their language, anti-German. So I do know that they focus very much in symbolism, and I don't think that, except for the violin solo in the beginning, the narrative goes like Chausson wrote it in the piece, but I do think there are many images that I can definitely take from this story, this novella. And of course I'm working on the sounds, the colors, the spiciness, the Indian kind of imagery, but it's, you know, it's hard to convey.
So it's a violin, right? It's like a,
yeah, it's a violin made of snake skin.
Of snake skin violin, with the magical powers that ends up impregnating her,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Somehow. But I do think, you know, those triplets where they started the piano, is that very difficult to play on the piano, by the way? Those da 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 da. I don't know, because I know, like,
I think it's very difficult not to make it like this.
You know, when I played the concert, the violin, piano, string quartet, that many people told me that's the most difficult piano part of any piece. You know, so I don't know. I don't know if this is similar, but maybe that is somehow sounds like the rustling in the garden, you know, maybe that somehow sets a scene. And then somebody gets stabbed, right? Somebody gets killed. And where do you think there's a moment in the piece where that happens?
I think, I don't recall the know there's a moment there that's like
could be, right? Yeah. And yeah, I guess I, yeah, so anyway, that's one thing. I wanted to ask you how long you've been playing this, why you chose to play it. I have a feeling that you really love this piece.
I really do love it.
I have to say, I feel the same. Yeah, amazing, amazing music. Yeah.
Yes, I think also playing it with Chen, you know, we've been playing for a while, and I contact her to play this because she has a specific, also type of, a specific way to see this music, this French music, and I don't know, I think it's, the language speaks to me very much, idioms in which it's written.
So it was your choice, you wanted to play this piece?
Yes, yes.
And when was that? When did you decide?
So I decided to play this semester starting in January, so we've been working on and off trying to find this.
Yeah. I guess while you were playing, I was thinking what to say, and maybe some of the things that we spoke before maybe are also similar. Say something about very simplifying a little bit the message for your listener. You know, I always think our job is like, I always say this, you know, I think our job is like the job of an actor. And we go on stage and we bring to life for our audience, you know, the ideal that's on the page, you know? And so I always think the simpler, the clearer, the better, you know? And so maybe something like that about very simpler rhythms, longer lines. Anyway, I'll stop talking. Do you want to play from violin entrance?
Okay. Beginning. Or you
yeah. Okay. Yeah, sure, from the beginning. Brava. Brava, brava. It's actually very similar to the beginning of the Ysaye, right? It starts very low and goes up to two octaves higher, right? And that's, I enjoyed this time a little more than maybe the first time.
I think I know what you mean.
Because I think you kept the rhythm clearer.
Yeah.
It was just very simple, you know? Sometimes you see a great actor, you know, in a on stage or even in a movie, and they speak their lines and they almost don't move their mouths, you know, and it's just somehow is more powerful, you know, it's just very simple, very you know, that fifth at the end, you know. I can't really see from here, but maybe you can if you look at your fingers. How about, just grab this, just grab that chord. Perfect. Now, lift your fingers up, grab it again. Yeah, and one more time. So See, I think, and I may be wrong, but I feel like you have no trouble grabbing that fifth, and you know exactly where it is. You've done it hundreds of times in the past. And what happens is, when you play in, and then when you move from this is the problem. So now I want you to play the note, the two notes before, and look at your fingers in the string. Just play that tritone. And now make sure that you're not pulling the string, you know, you're not pulling or pushing. Yeah. In fact, what happens if you just lift your fingers and grab it, you know? Yeah.
Yeah.
But make sure you're looking. So my point is, if you can avoid pulling,
yeah,
don't pull. Maybe it helps to push your elbow in a little bit so it's square on the string. And anyway, don't let the note before interfere with the next one, you know. Just if you can even lift your fingers lightly, you know, even if you can, you know, I can't really, you know, it doesn't have to be all the way down. Then it may be easier to grab that fifth. But I think if the strings, if you leave them alone and you come out of nowhere and grab that fifth, you know exactly where it is. Mm-hmm. I think it's really about the kind of being square.
Okay.
I don't know, basketballers always talk about squaring up for the shot. And if you see the great shooters, they're always square when they take the shot. It doesn't matter, you know? So it's just something about relax, square up, and hit it, you know?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, do you want to play that thing again, and then we'll go on?
This thing I just played, or?
Yeah, from that opening. I just, it's so beautiful. The snakeskin violin.
Thank you.
Bravi, 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 bravi. So that's kind of the answer, right? The whole time we keep going up to the high B flat. And this is the answer. And finally we get the answer. Right? We finally answer that that climb that we had before. You know, this is a kind of a mishigas, kind of a pet thing that I have that started maybe 10 or 15 years ago. And I don't know if other people feel the same. I don't know if Dima feels the same. When I hear whole tone trills, you know, so this one's fine, half set. But when I hear whole tone trills, for me, the top note always feels flat. I always want it to be high. And it's a strange thing because I feel the same when I hear piano play whole tone trills. I always want to hear the high note higher. And very often I hear violinists, myself included, that I start the trill and it's a little flat, and then it gets flatter and flatter as the trill goes by, you know? So, you know what, that top, right? And then the highest note we've played so far is, right? That's the highest note. It's a strange thing. The older I got, the higher octaves starting around there, like, what is that? Fifth, sixth position, something like that, whatever it is. I want things to be higher, higher. When you talk to piano technicians, they don't tune they spread the octaves. So like we want to tune it to the open A, but I don't anymore. I always want it a little bit higher. So piano technicians do this. They if you listen to their octaves, they're quite big. They spread them and spread them. Anyway, so do you want to play from that top? That's, yeah, maybe a little higher. I don't mind if it's that high. I like it.
Okay. Here we go. Sorry, I'm trying to find it.
Sounds good to me. That one sounded good to me.
Okay, so. Okay.
How did it feel? What did you think? I really liked it. How did you like it?
I will definitely try it. I just have to push it a little bit because I think the finger gets tired. That's all.
Yeah, same. The same. Yeah. My only other thought here is I think you can really use a lot more bow. Do you want to do just from there? Yeah, just for you. Uh-huh. I think even no bow pressure, you know. Beautiful, beautiful. Let's go on. Let's go on.
Right there?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, maybe let's go on. From number seven. Brava, 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 brava. Two quick thoughts. One is, you know, when you come down to this, you are right in the thick of the piano harmony. It's your lowest note. I couldn't really hear it, you know. I'm not there in the room, you know. But I think anyway, my experience, those bottom notes, you need to punch out, you know, or maybe hold them a little longer or something.
Okay.
And the other, oh, what was the other? Oh, yeah. So, you know how you have. Right? So, you know, the older I get, I try to come up with rules, you know. You know, like my teacher, I remember when I was a kid, I used to play for my teacher. I would stand and he would sit and he would say, Gil, every trill needs an accent at the beginning. And I would stand there and I would think, how do you know every trill? You know, maybe some trills don't need an accent, you know, but turns out he was right. And so every trill needs an accent, you know, like the composer wants to emphasize the note, so he puts a trill, so it needs, anyway, I feel like whenever you have a tie over the next beat, or sometimes a dotted note, I mean, in this case, dotted would be confusing, but something, right? If you, I always want to crescendo into the tie. You don't want to lose steam before the beat, because the whole tension is the beat changes, but your note still, I mean, the beat changes, but your note still stays. You know, that's the whole tension. Sometimes it's a suspension in the counterpoint, you know, but. Right? Even this one. Right? So you never want to peter out before the beat changes. You know, if I were to try to do that, it would sound like. That's maybe I'm exaggerating, but it's always, I think, always nice to. Yeah? Okay, I'll stop talking and I'll. Do you want to play? Where's a good place for you to start?
Seven is good.
Yeah, it's so beautiful.
It's hard to split it.
Yeah. I'd be happy to hear it again if you're up for playing it again. Brava. Oh, what did I do? Oh, there. That top. Da-da-da-da. I mean, it's such a awkward thing. Nailed it. I mean, when I was growing up, our teachers never had us practice half diminished arpeggios, right? Maybe we should have, you know? My feeling is that da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Maybe you need to bring your elbow in. Da, 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 and it'll be maybe even more, you know? Okay. Then the fourth finger will square up better.
I'm actually doing three, but yes, I do feel that the elbow is not. No, I don't trust.
So what is your fingering at the end for the A, C, E flat, G?
That'd be a long time.
Oh, cool. Which me. I see. So you're shifting on the C's.
In the C's, exactly. I tried so many other ones. And...
Definitely, I think for me it's easier with the elbowing. Yes! I had just one quick thought about this. I know we're running out of time, but I mean, it would be great if you could play like a MIDI, you know, and not take any time. You know, if you could really not take any time. But since you are going to take time, and I think many people do, just maybe the bottom note needs to be longer, needs to be singing, and you know. You know, make sure that the bottom note gets all the, you know, all the affection it needs. And then I was wondering, once you're, is it, are you intentionally slowing down for I just wasn't sure, so it wasn't clear, you know. Somehow, I guess the piano. Am I right? The piano has
a theme.
Fast notes until there, and then they stop right at 9.
That's what she has, right?
But I mean, just before that, she keeps having like running. What is it? The syncopations. Is it? Or? No, sorry. Oh, yeah, it is. Right, so she keeps having, you have 16th notes between you the whole time until 9, and then they stop.
Okay.
Do you want to do a couple of bars before, maybe from the D? The G major chord. Brava, brava. You know, you can even do it earlier, I think, if it's comfortable.
Yeah.
The one thing at the bar before, you know, da 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 da. You know, piano has da 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 da. It's nice if you continue the 16ths, you know, da 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 da. You know, I know we are running out of time, and you know, do you want to play from the Allegro?
It'd be great, yeah. Oh, wait, Allegro. You mean 17, right?
17.
Okay.
Oh, I love it. Thank you.
this passage.
Bravi, bravi, bravi. I like those trills. That was great. Those whole note trills. Yeah, I just had one question, but I may be wrong, but could it be that 20, that first note should be a B? I don't know.
G, actually, in my part.
G, yeah, I have G in my part too. Huh. I don't know why I thought maybe.
Okay, but
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know this piece. I never played this piece, so I don't want to say.
No, I'll keep it.
Oh, no, but actually piano has like a G major. No, actually, she has a D. She has a D in the piano part. It's so interesting. But does that sound right, the D? What about the D in the piano part? Does that sound...
Yeah, that sounds so weird, actually. It doesn't arrive. I mean, it's not the actual arrival anyway, but...
You're right, it's like the 6-4 chord, right? Anyway, something to think about. I don't know. Well, it sounds beautiful. Do you want to finish it? Do you want to go from... Yeah, for after 21 there. Bravi, bravi, Bo. Thank you. Thank you for playing. Keep up the great work.
We'll do the best.
Yeah, beautiful.
Thank you, Bo. Thank you, Daniel. It was wonderful, Gil. Thank you for all your suggestions and very joyful and involved involved sessions. You are like a child. You're very excited still about some things you learn along.
But dude, for me, I never played these pieces, so I feel
know,
like
you take it, you know, like with such a joy, which one should always. I think it's a very important quality for a musician to feel this discovery. It's always like, you know, for the first time, even if you heard the piece for hundreds of times.
I agree. You know Adele, right? My wife.
Yeah, she's a wonderful violinist.
We're both musicians, you know, but my brother is a scientist and he plays piano, and he joined this Greenwich Village Symphony here in New York.
I played with this orchestra like 30 years ago when I just came to...
You know them, right?
Yeah.
So he started playing the piano parts for some of their pieces, and it was really inspiring because he called up, he says, "We're doing Shostakovich 5, you know, bum, 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 bum." He says, "Did you know that he was in love with this woman and he was inspired by the opera Carmen?" And da, 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 da. You know, it's and so Adele and I, you know, we would hear him talk. He'd be like, you know, "Aziz by Ravel, you have to learn this piece. It's such a great piece." Well, I didn't know it, but Adele and I would be looking at each other and we were like, we should be like that. We should be like that, right? Like, it's tempting for musicians to become kind of, I don't know if cynical, but maybe to take this this stuff for granted.
Yes, but I think it's great, actually, one of the aspects of teaching, it's wonderful to always to have a fresh ear for some new repertoire. And since you're now teaching, it's your first year, right? You just started, both of you started officially in Bard, at the Bard House.
Well, Adele has been teaching for a long time. She was at Juilliard for a long time. And now both of us took up positions at Bard. And for me, it was my first year teaching. And I just loved it, you know, it's so inspiring. You know, I learn much more than my students. You know, Dima, how long have you been teaching?
You know, I've been teaching at Michigan State for 20 years, but before I was doing something also, not maybe on a regular basis, but I had some students, even Ms. DeLay and Masao Kawasaki. You know, I had some of the students from at that time when we were still at school. I worked with a couple of people. So, you know, I've always enjoyed it. And it's a journey, too, because you approach... you know, this process with a new student, the same piece, but you see that there's a different way. And it's also very, very inspiring for me to see that how it's endless opportunities, and you learn with a new student, a different angle of the piece also. And sometimes, I'm sure you will do the same, but sometimes I give a new piece to the student so I can learn that piece together.
Yeah.
It's fun for both of us, actually, over the pandemic time. I've done several caprices I give to my students.
Paganini caprices.
So I realized in order for me to really give another advices, I have to play them myself. So it was a great experience, actually. And I keep doing some regular, actually, caprices and finding more fun in them, you know?
Oh, yeah. I love those pieces, you know? Yeah.
I wanted to ask you, actually, over the years, I'm sure you find something which works for you, you know, how you warm up, how you keep yourself in shape, how you keep...
I'm the worst. I have no...
No routine?
No routine. Do you? Do you have...
You know, I have different... Depending, you know, we have to be, you know, conscious in a sense that we feel if something is not working, then you have to pay attention. Like being almost like a doctor, we have to give yourself... ourselves the diagnosis, you know, if something you feel that suddenly, so you have to be creative and come up, perhaps instead of just playing etudes for me, which is boring, either I'll do some pieces, some cadences or some passages which can emphasize certain sides which I would like to improve, and at the same time I keep myself, you know, creatively inspired. it's an advantage of having a broader repertoire, so you can right away pick something and maybe practice particular passages from the different pieces.
You know, when I started playing concerts, so when I was even a, I guess teenager, early 20s, you know, let's say I was playing a concerto, I would play it through 10 times every day, including the concert day.
Really?
Yes. I remember this. I just was
playing Brahms concerto or Beethoven concerto 10 times through?
10 times, 5 hours, you know, or whatever it is. You know, and then I want to say we had kids, you know. And then we had kids, and at some point it was like, I hope I remember to bring the bow, you know. And so somehow life got crazier and busier, and I was just like, I have to learn to be more efficient. There's got to be ways of being more efficient. And yeah, you know, I'm playing Hindemith Concerto for the first time next April. So I've already started working on it. You know, before, when I was young, I would never be this organized. But now I see the wisdom, you know, of being organized. So now I'm, you know, I do a little bit every day, even if it's just 2-3 minutes. But if you do it every day, somehow, I don't know, in the back of your head it grows, or there's kind of, and the other really most efficient thing that I found was recording myself. I don't know if you record yourself. I haven't brought myself to start videotaping yet, because I think that might be too embarrassing, but maybe, you know, I should.
All over this pandemic time, I was doing some blended teaching in person and on Zoom, of course. I started doing a lot. So I realized right away, because I watched some of the recordings, some of the videos, and it's very easy now to just to push the button. And I started actually learning new pieces and just making it. In a way, it's very, very convenient, and it's important to go through this process. Maybe not all the time, but especially when we learn a new piece.
And especially, you know, if you're playing a chamber music piece or with orchestra, and you know, you don't really have the perspective of you know, your phone that records, you know, and then when, you know, when you listen back, there are things that you could practice for months, you would never know, but now you heard it.
Yeah, so you can right away react and change, yeah, and maybe record it again and see how it's different. Yeah, it's true. This is one of the advantages of technology. Listen, I want to ask you before we end this webinar, maybe you could share some of the memorable suggestions or some of the advices from Ms. DeLay, from Isaac Stern. I know you were very close with Isaac, and you were fortunate to play concerts with Isaac and perhaps other wonderful musicians of that time. What there was something special, I'm sure you were able to, you know, to get from them.
You know, I am just now when you were saying that, I was trying to think what I was really very lucky with my teachers. You know, I studied with a wonderful professor in Jerusalem by the name of Shmuel Bernstein, you know, who was a Lithuanian violinist by origin, who I think he ended up in Hamburg, and then during the war ended up as a refugee in Israel. And by the time I was studying with him, he was in his 80s, but he was just very passionate about music. And, but anyway, I had really wonderful teachers, Jens Ellermann and Miss DeLay and Hyo Kang, and, you know, so inspired. And Felix Gallimir, you know. And then you mentioned Isaac Stern, and I thought, you know, one time Mr. Stern said to me, you should talked to Carl Schachter. I don't know if you know, Carl Schachter wrote many music theory books, and he taught, I think, at the Manus School for a long time. And anyway, I couldn't quite reach Carl Schachter, but I met an incredible musician by the name of Eric Wen. And Eric is a violinist, but he really is a music theorist. You know, he does Schenkerian analysis. And as a teenager, I think it really changed my life, you know. It was a real passion for music, and it was really sort of talking about the grammar of this language. You know, it's mostly, you know, tonal language. You know, Schenker analyzes Bach and Beethoven and Brahms, but it also applies to, you know, more modern composers. So I don't know, somehow when you said that, I thought, you know, maybe somebody like Eric Wen was such an inspiration. Yeah, somebody who loved music and sort of maybe was a different angle from violinist. He was a violinist, but it was a different angle from the instrument and just thinking about this, yeah, this language. Okay, I'll one last story, but then I'll stop. But you remember René Morel, right?
Of course, yeah, he was an incredible doctor of all of our instruments.
At the Jacques Francais shop. And René Morel was very kind to me. You know, I would come in and he would say, you know, with a strong French accent, he would say, "Gil, you will be a very good violinist." You know, made me feel great. You know, he said, "You will be a very good violinist because you listen to everybody. And you try to learn from everybody, you know?" And, you know, now I'm older. I know he was just in a very kind way saying, "Hey, you know, you bratty kid, listen." You know, he was in a very nice way trying to get me to listen. But I think that's true, you know? You really can learn from everybody. Everybody has so much to offer. You know, and music is a whole universe in the back of our heads. So, yeah.
Certainly, but there are some moments, especially when in our youth, you know, I can definitely relate to some of my teachers who inspired me. But there are sometimes some like turning points in terms of the being aware of certain things or the way one should practice.
I see you thinking of some specific memory. Do you have a specific memory?
Yeah, I have several ones. It's just, it has to take another. But I remember one of my teachers, I have also wonderful teacher back in Soviet time. And when you said that you played 10 times something or 5 times the concerto, I had one teacher who was a really quite elderly man, and he lived right across from my house. And I would come, before a concert, I would come to his apartment and I would play a piece through. And then I felt like, you know, I already got, you know, a little bit over, you know, excited and nervous. And since he was very kind to me and he would, you know, encourage me, then I would go to perform and I felt much more, you know, assured that everything is going to be right. And there was a tradition. Unfortunately, I just spent a little bit over a year with him. His name is Boris Sergei, but he was one of the most well-known teachers, especially for the younger kids. I was maybe 11 years old when I studied with him. It's one of the story. And another later one, when my dear friend and teacher, Mikhail Bezverkhny, he introduced me to practicing without bow. So I would really imagine what kind of sound, even for the intonation, for the shiftings, for anything, just to be aware that it's something more mental than just the physical. And then you have to really find some kind of harmony. And the moment you anticipate what you're going to do, the moment you really engage your creative ability, your hand is going to listen. So from just mechanical repetition, I started, and it was a crucial point for me when I was learning Paganini concerto and all that stuff, very virtuosic stuff, just to be aware that you know, you don't have to repeat 100 times. You can just a couple of times, just to find your relationship to the fingerboard.
Yes.
Without the bow, and then you check, especially, you know, with the long jumps, you check a couple of times, and then you don't worry about this anymore, because you start feeling the fingerboard in a different way. So those, I mean, there are many advices like the small ones, but they really make a huge difference. Yeah. I wanted to ask you, because I'm also very curious to hear your new recording. You just did Beethoven Concerto recently.
Thanks.
And there's slightly different arrangement of concerto?
Oh, no, no. No, we did, so this is the Knights in New York. They're chamber orchestra.
Yes.
They started out as chamber musicians who would get together and sight read. And then they grew and grew, and now they're really an excellent chamber orchestra. And maybe, I don't know if you were at the same time with Colin Jacobson.
I've met him. I know, of course.
He's a great, great violinist, but he also now plays viola and composes, and he leads the Knights. And his brother Eric is a wonderful cellist who conducts them. And you know, I heard them do a great Beethoven symphony. They did the Eroica in Chicago, and I really loved it. And I said, hey, maybe, do you want to do the concerto? And we did Beethoven concerto, and we thought maybe we can do the Brahms. And I found that it worked beautifully with that sort of smaller forces, you know, especially with, you know, in the Brahms, there's so much counterpoint, and there's so much... There's something
well,
nice
like
about
chamber
that.
Chamber music, yeah? When you
yeah, play. Chamber music, like, exactly. Yeah, so we did that. During the pandemic, we did a Beethoven, a little bit kind of like Hummel. I don't know if you know those. Hummel arranged those symphonies. He arranged all the Beethoven symphonies. Not all, 1 through 7, I think. I'm not sure. And some of the overtures he arranged for... violin, cello, flute, and piano. I think that was the arrangement. So we tried to do kind of a similar arrangement, you know, during COVID of the violin concerto, but we couldn't do it without the timpani. So we kept the timpani as well. Yeah.
That's wonderful. I think there's an arrangement I played, I think it's a second symphony for the piano trio.
Yeah, it's amazing to think about, you know, music kind of had a different life back then that maybe now we don't have, you know. Hey, let's get together and read a Beethoven symphony. Would be fun.
Listen, and also today I ask you, and I think it would be great if you would share, because it's quite unusual to see you playing on the modern violin. Maybe you can share it, because...
Oh. Yeah, this is a beautiful violin by Andranik Gabarian. I enjoy playing it. You know, I'm very lucky that I play a Stradivarius from a group in New York, Rare Violins of New York, called In Consortium, where, you know, they lend out violins to...
Yeah, Bruno Price and Zephyr.
Exactly, yeah.
Landolfi from them when they just started about 17 years ago. I was, I think, one of the first clients with them.
Brilliant. Is that the Landolfi behind you there?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Always sounds so beautiful. Yeah. Yeah. So I'm very lucky to play that wonderful Strad. And I also have this modern violin. Yes. So yeah, very lucky. Andranik Gabarian. He's a Massachusetts-based maker.
Armenian, yes.
Armenian, a former violinist from, I think, Moscow Conservatory, who started making his own instruments. And many...
I would love that. I mean, it sounds wonderful on Zoom, and I'm sure it sounds even better in real life.
Thanks. No, many of the BSO players play his instruments, violin and viola. I don't know if he makes I don't know. I don't think he makes cellos, but maybe. Yeah.
Listen, I just want to ask you before we really end this. I'm just curious for you. I'm thinking lately about this. What, when you go and perform, what do you consider really for yourself? What is your criteria that this concert was really something special for me today? What needs to happen on stage that you feel that we don't feel it every time, but we, you know, we have to cherish this moment. What is this for you that you feel you go play with the orchestra, with a great orchestra conductor or a wonderful pianist partner? What are you looking for to happen? What kind of magic?
You know, it's a Perlman. He's often, he jokes, you know, he says, oh, of all the concerts I've played, last night was one of them, you know? I am really into this idea now of experiencing the moment, you know? It's very strange. Jan Fogler, you know, the cellist, he was doing these concerts with Bill Murray, who is one of my heroes. You know, I love his movies, Groundhog Day and everything.
He is incredible, yeah, very natural.
I always thought, kind of a genius, you know, and I heard him talking about improv, you know, he would do comedy improv and he would react to the people he was with and whatever they did, he would react, and he talks about experiencing the moment, experiencing the instant, and I think that's right, you know, for us too. You know, like you say, you come to a concert, you do your best to be as prepared, you know, you work hard, you come on stage, you want to feel confident, you want to create a moment, you know, or create, achieve something with the music. And then you want to react to the moments and share it with the people that you're there. And I think you feel it. I think at the end of if you feel something went well afterwards, I think you feel it, you know, deep down. You're like, I think we made a moment, you know, a moment happened.
But I think audience is also very sensitive to those moments. When something happens really at that moment on the stage, it feels like, I mean, you don't think about this, but suddenly you feel that if there's a silence in the hall, that everyone is actually like almost breathing with the music, with you. So you feel that this is a moment, actually, it's very special when you feel that everyone is listening and experiencing this together with you, because you're in the process of discovery and the audience is also.
We're sharing, yeah, and that's exactly right. And sometimes it's literally breathing together. Sometimes you see people listening to music and people are breathing together, you know? Of course, dancing would be great, but we don't see that often in concert halls. But you see people moving together or breathing together, and you really share it. And I guess, I don't know, maybe now with the last year, I feel like we especially crave that, you know? We won't be taking that for granted anymore, you know, bringing people together and sharing music.
And breathing without masks.
And breathing without masks too, really.
Yeah.
Did you change how you wash your hands last year? So forever, I was always, oh, I should wash my hands, you know, because violin and this, I'm always washing. But then the beginning of last year, I was like, oh, you know, and you know, with the tips of the fingers and between the fingers and the thumbs and the wrists. I don't know. Did you?
No, I think I keep the same track what I've been doing before. I'm just trying to be a little bit more careful. Listen, it was real joy to be with you. And I'm sure for every attendee, we had many, many attendees today. And hopefully everyone will remember this wonderful time with you, and definitely students were very happy to have this interaction with
Yeah,
you.
well, bravi to the students. Yeah, and what an honor. I'm so happy to have been with you. Thank you for thinking of me. Thank you for asking me. So happy to see you. So happy.
Hopefully we'll do something again in
be
the
with you.
in person in real life when you come to Michigan. Maybe you'll have some plans soon to come to Detroit, or so there's some great orchestra in Kalamazoo and in the area, so we'll look forward for another class with you.
Oh, I would love it. I would love it.
And I would like to thank again everyone who supports this series, and especially Lauren Harris, our professor of psychology at MSU, and my former student Austin Burket, who has been great help with artwork, with some materials and editing videos, which later will be streamed on the Violin channel. So we're looking forward to more Dorothy DeLay masterclasses. It has been an incredible season since October. I think we had 18 wonderful, distinguished artists, and the next one is going to be Itzhak Perlman with his wife Toby. They're going to do just a session of question and answers next week. So we look forward for many, many more, and I really appreciate your time and your kindness and your joyful presence, Gil. All the best to you.
Thank you, and to you too, Dima.
Bye-bye, everyone. Thank you.